Hey guys, how's it going? Welcome to Evening Devotion. Tonight we're going to be reading out of Psalm 113:8, that he may set him with princes. So we're going to read the whole thing. This is the whole verse, is that he may set him with princes, with the princes of his people. So let's go up to the first verse. This is titled, Who is like the Lord our God? Verse 1, praise the Lord. Praise, O servants of the Lord. Praise the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord from this time forth and forevermore. From the rising of the sun to its going down, the Lord's name is to be praised. The Lord is high above all nations, his glory above the heavens. Who is like the Lord our God who dwells on high? Who humbles himself to behold the things that are in the heavens and in the earth? He raises the poor out of the dust and lifts the needy out of the ash heap, that he may seat him with princes, with the princes of his people. He grants the barren woman a home, like a joyful mother of children. Praise the Lord. Short psalm, amazing psalm. Our spiritual privileges are of the highest order. Among princes is the place of select society. Truly our fellowship is with the Father and with his Son, Jesus Christ. Speak of select society. There is none like this. We are a chosen generation, a peculiar people, a royal priesthood. That when people read that particular verse, that seems to completely and solely be addressed to the Jews. It's all who believe, because he says that in those surrounding verses. It's for all who believe. We are a chosen generation. I've told you guys this. Are we not a chosen generation? Sure we are. Look at what we're seeing today. No other generation has been allowed to see this. Other generations have longed to see this. Going all the way back to the beginning, they've never been allowed to see this, and here we are. When we get on the other side, some are going to ask us, I imagine, some are going to ask us, what was it like? What was it like being there, watching it happen? Because they wanted to know. A peculiar people. We are a peculiar people. That's why they all want us to leave. A royal priesthood. We are come unto the general assembly and church of the firstborn, whose names are written in heaven. Your name and my name is written in heaven. So people in heaven know our name. The saints have courtly audience. Princes have admittance to royalty when common people must stand afar off. The child of God has free access to the inner courts of heaven. For through him, we both have access by one Spirit unto the Father. Let us come boldly, says the apostle, to the throne of the heavenly grace. Among princes there is abundant wealth, but what is the abundance of princes compared with the riches of believers? For all things are yours, and ye are Christ's, and Christ is God's. So if all things are ours, we belong to Christ. That means everything that's Christ is ours. Christ belongs to God. That means everything God have is ours. I'm going to pause for a minute and give you a chance to sit and think about that. Think about what that means. All things are ours. He that spared not his own son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him also freely give us all things? It comes down to that same question. Do you really believe? Do we believe? That's it. Princes have peculiar power. A prince of heaven's empire has great influence. He wields a scepter in his own domain. He sits upon Jesus' throne, for he hath made us kings and priests unto God, and we shall reign forever and ever. We reign over the united kingdom of time and eternity. Princes, again, have special honor. We may look down upon all earth-born dignity from the eminence upon which grace has placed us. You ever wonder why in the book of Revelation it says that, you know, when it gets into the second half of the tribulation and it starts talking about that people won't repent of their murders and sorceries, but instead they curse the citizens of heaven. Why do they curse the citizens of heaven? Because they wanted the high place and didn't get it. And we did, even though we didn't want it. We were the least, and they wanted us under thumb, but instead we were taken up, and we get to sit in the highest place, and they will never get there. That's just one reason why they curse us. For what is human grandeur to this? He hath raised us up together, and made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. We share the honor of Christ, and compared with this, earthly splendors are not worth a thought. Communion with Jesus is a richer gem than ever glittered the imperial diadem. Union with the Lord is a coronet of beauty outshining all the blaze of imperial pomp. You know, there is no royalty on this earth or that has ever been on this earth that even comes close to the majesty and the grandeur and the royalty of God the Father and His Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ having taken even a higher position than what He had before, in that He redeemed the purchased possession. In that He humbled Himself and then shed His blood for all of mankind. What an amazing thing to do. What an incredible thing to do. We scarcely understand the depths of the meaning of that. When we get to heaven, we'll understand. Because of all that, we have access to that. Because Jesus has imputed those things unto us, we have access to all of those things. The Father lost something that day. His Son gave Him up to be a sacrifice. But He gained much more. Not only did He get His Son back, but He got a victorious Son back, who, with His own blood, redeemed creation. And the Father gained an entire family of children. All who would believe will come and stand before His throne. So anybody who doesn't think God knows what He's doing, I want to take a step back and take another look. He definitely knows what He's doing. And this will go exactly the way He said it's going to go. And it's staggering to me how many people out there calling themselves Christians, but they don't believe what He says. They don't believe the Bible. They don't believe that God's going to do all these things. And they go out of their way to change what they believe. I don't understand that. That makes no sense to me. Oh, I love God. I love Jesus Christ. Really? Then why don't you believe His word? Well, I do. Except for this part and this part, or this part. You don't believe those things. Well, there's some problems with the interpretation, and we can ignore those parts. God won't be upset about that. Really? That's shocking. Because He said His whole word would stay true. He would preserve His word. What word do we have from God? This one right here. Are you telling me you're going to go through and pick all the spots out where He spoke and say that's the word He was talking about? No, it's the entire Bible. God would not allow us without at least one access to one truth that isn't convoluted and corrupted by lies surrounding it. The whole book is full of truth. The whole book is truth. And that is the only access and the only place where we will find it, because it comes from Him that's in this world. And yet people still want to pull it apart and say, oh, well, we don't have to believe all of it. Really? And you call yourself a Christian? That's shocking. It's shocking that you would think that's okay, knowing the Father. Obviously, you have no fear of the Father, because if you did, it would terrify you to even think that there's a possibility that you could misrepresent His word. It terrifies me to do what I do. I kid you not. I worry that I'm not going to do it right. I worry that I'm going to misrepresent it. I don't want to do that. And I've gone to Him in prayer multiple times about that. Lord, I don't want to misrepresent Your word and Your truth. I want to speak it as clearly and convey the message as simply and perfectly as I can for Your glory. Because it's not my message. And there are many out there who don't care. So the reason why I told you all that is because that is an action of a prince or a king. That's an action of a priest. Somebody who genuinely cares about the truth and wants the truth to be spoken without adding themselves into it. A non-believer or somebody who's backslidden or somebody who's apostatized, they don't care. They believe whatever makes them feel good. That's a shame. There is only one truth, His. And it's in this book, and it's our job to figure it out what it says, to find it, And the more we lean into it, and the more we go to Him, and the more we do the things He tells us to do, the more He reveals that truth to us and gives us more access to it. And the pages come alive. We start to see more, know more, learn more, and then ultimately be changed to become more like Him. Brothers and sisters, we are seated in heavenly places. The position you see yourself in right now in your life, whoever you are listening, you are still seated in heavenly places. Spiritually, you are already there. We are all already there. We're just waiting for the redemption of the body. Then we will be there physically. What a day that is going to be. What an incredible moment that's going to be. When all the truth becomes realized fully and we're like, oh, okay, now I really know what that meant. Now I really understand what that meant. Why did I ever question or doubt in this life? Now I see the truth. Well, we can have enough of that truth to set us free here, but when we get up there, we will be free indeed, free of all of this. You are of a royal bloodline. You have been born again and adopted into a royal bloodline. Believe it. That's what the Bible says. Don't let anyone tell you otherwise. Don't let anyone look down on you and question you and coerce you and condemn you and assault you because they think they're something and they think you're nothing because you don't look like, sound like, act like, smell like, think like, everything like them. I learned in my life, and I learned this the very hardest way you can, from the time I was a small child to now, the constant striving to be like everybody else and fit in and never, ever doing it, ever. And I always wondered, why is that? I see all these other guys falling in and they get popular and they fall in, you know, and even when they're treated badly in grade school, they figure it out in high school. I never figured it out. I never could. No matter where I worked, no matter where I lived, nothing. Never could fit in with anybody. And I so desperately wanted to. Well, maybe there's a reason why I didn't. And I think now I'm starting to realize why I didn't. Because I wasn't the world's. I never belonged to the world. I belonged to Him. Even before I was saved, I already look back in the past and I see very interesting events that happened that tell me that He had been working with me for quite a while before I got saved. And that I've always belonged to Him. Never belonged here. Never belonged to anyone else. Never belonged in any group. And that's why I don't feel like I fit in anywhere. I enjoy my own company more than I do most everybody else's. Because when I'm by myself, that's when He's standing right next to me. And even when I'm with others, He's standing right next to me. We're not of the world. We're different. We're citizens of heaven, part of the general assembly of heaven. Very soon, we're going to take our place there. Should it be a surprise that things are so the way they are here, especially against Christians? You know, between the two most hated groups in the world, the whole world, are Jews and Christians. And as of last year, we surpassed the Jews in people hating us and persecution. Passed them. Oh, they're still heavily persecuted, but it's gotten worse for Christians because they're trying to figure out how to take the Jews out and they can't. And so they think, okay, well, let's take out their allies. Who's the Jews' allies? Christians. Okay, we'll take the Christians out and then we can get the Jews. We're going to take every ally they have out of this world. And if they could do it, they would come and they would take us all and they would lock us away. They could do it right now. They would do it. I shudder to think that if another Democrat gets in the president's office, that's the last president, it'll turn into a monarchy. They're going to shut that down by executive order. And they're going to round up all the Christians. You watch. If it happens. I don't think so. I think Trump has to get in. I think we'll be taken after that. Now, after that happens, then they're going to come after anybody who believes after we're taken, after we leave. The Bible talks about that stuff. It talks about how there's going to be a worldwide onslaught against anyone who believes. You become a Christian in the tribulation, you're not going to be able to run far enough or fast enough. They're going to hunt all of them down. What's amazing is that people are even going to come to faith in the second half because it says that the Antichrist decides to take control. I'm God. I'm here on the throne. I'm going after every believer on this planet. And he makes war with every believer he can find. Amazing. It's no wonder we're treated the way we are, because we don't belong here. We're not part of the world. The world won't accept it. The world loves its own. It doesn't love us. And the world never will love us. You know what? That's fine with me, because I have a Lord that has fully accepted me. That's what drew me to Him, because I found in Him what I couldn't find anywhere else: acceptance. Complete 100% acceptance in Christ Jesus. Now I'm a child of God, soon to be fully realized. I am seated in heavenly places, soon to be fully realized. I'm a king, a priest to Him. And we'll rule with Him forever, soon to be fully realized. And every single one of you that believes has the same thing. That's what the Bible says. I believe it. Is that what the Bible says? I believe it. Now people will say, well, that's very arrogant of you. Is it? Because I'm not sitting out here touting myself as being anything. I just know what's coming. I have these things because the Bible tells me I have these things. But I'm not going to lord it over somebody or hold it over somebody's head. I'm not going to make myself out to be something that I'm not. Because the whole point of knowing those things is to keep you humble. Look what the Lord did. He did this for me. Who am I that He would do that for me? I need to stay very humble. You don't belong here. I don't belong here. We're camping. We're living in this tent. We have a mansion waiting. A perfect body. Perfect in every way. When the time comes, we're going to take that over and dwell in that body forever. We can't even fathom what that's going to be like. But what will be amazing is that we will no longer have to try to survive here, because we will stand with Him in eternal life. I look forward to that way. And Lord, I thank You that we have that. And I thank You that we have Your word that tells us that. May we all believe it completely, perfectly, and totally. May we all look to You for all things. May we take what Your word says and believe it, but that in the fact that it keeps us humble and reminds us of what we should do and how we should be towards everyone around us. Because knowing what we know about ourselves, we should have compassion and pity on everyone else who isn't in that position, and maybe share some truth with them and hopefully get them to believe so that they can come join us. Nevertheless, Lord, I thank You for this word of truth that we can rely on, this perfect word we can go to and believe every single day, no matter what, no matter what they say. And it is amazing to witness Your prophecies coming true, especially the ones about the apostasy, and that's happening, and that they would believe the lie, the great delusion, and that's happening. And that great delusion is that, well, at least a part of it is that this Bible isn't true. And people are believing it, and yet they still go to church on Sunday. I don't understand that. I don't understand the mentality. Depraved mind is all I can come up with. So, Lord, here we are in a very unique time in human history. A time that is more talked about than anything else that has ever happened. And we're right up against that. And that's amazing. The only other time that compares is when You came, when You arrived. We see that all of human history is wrapping up. Lord, make us to pass on to the next one triumphantly. And make us to overcome with faith. No matter what we see, no matter what we hear, no matter what goes on, may we never, ever, ever relent from standing with You. Even if it means the worst possible scenario, which for us would be the best. They send us home to be with You. Thank You, Lord, and I bless You, and I thank You, and I pray these things in Your name. Amen. Guys, thank you for joining me for evening devotion. It's hard sometimes to get our brain wrapped around this and to take comfort from it. But you know, with the way the world is today, where we can't find any comfort, that's the only place we have to look to find comfort. The truth of the word. And this is why he tells us, you know, Paul tells the Thessalonians, comfort each other with these words, talking about the rapture of the church. You getting that from anybody else? Nope. Most other people, almost all of them, are talking about a lack of hope, a lack of encouragement, a lack of any of that stuff. And they're speaking of it like it's like, you better get ready, you got to survive. I think they're using that as an excuse to prep. And I did a video series on that. I got a playlist on it. We're not to prep. We're to prepare, but not prep. the stuff that they got people trying to do, and these people pretending to be Christians, telling people you better fill your garage, better fill your basement. You know, most people can't afford that. You better move out of the country. Most people can't afford that. What are they supposed to do? See, it's very selfish to do what they're doing. It takes a very high level of self-importance to do what they're doing. You're supposed to help your brothers and sisters. But what they're doing doesn't do that. We do it the way the Lord told us to do it. Be prudent, but look to Him for all things. We have a great example of the Lord doing that in the world now. Generally, it's accepted that at the midway point of the tribulation, when it says they're going to, the remnant is going to head south, it's generally accepted they're going to go to Petra. And there's a little area of caves just adjacent to that. Well, there are so many people in the world today that know that that's the case, that they are actually preparing that place. Generators, seeds, food, everything they could possibly need are all being stored, even by the Saudis, in those caves for the Jews. Saudis know what they're doing. They know why they're doing it. And then whenever you go on the tour and they take you down there, they tell you to get your notes and your Bibles and whatever, wrap them in plastic, and you get to bury them and stuff them in the corners. There's Bibles all over down there. They're preparing the area. That's how sure they are that's where they're going to go. You don't think God put that on their heart? Sure He did. And we see that He's already providing provision for them when they get there. Amazing. Amazing. Doesn't get any better than that. Doesn't get any better than that. Incredible. It's incredible, and we know it's God. So if He'll do that for them, He's going to do it for us too. Have faith. Overcome the world with faith. That's what John said. Who is he who overcomes than the one that has that believes Jesus is the Son of God? Indeed. I love you all very much. I bless you all in Jesus' name, and I'll see you in the next video.